The next item of business is a members' business debate on motion 768 in the name of Miles Briggs on SCVO creates its 10,000th CJS job in Scotland's voluntary sector. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Miles Briggs to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and apologies for the length of the title of my motion. But I'm very grateful for members for supporting the motion today and for those who have remained this afternoon to take part in the debate. Across Scotland, there are young people facing barriers to employment. Often these are multiple and complex, and caring responsibilities being one of the key ones, but also learning disabilities or health issues that make it hard to get or maintain a job. And now more than ever, those furthest away from the labour market face multiple disadvantages compounded by the impact of the pandemic. So it's my pleasure today to be able to offer some good news, and don't we just need that? Because we are today celebrating the 10,000th person to find a job through the Community Jobs Scotland programme. The Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations set up Community Jobs Scotland 10 years ago in 2011. Employers and young people in every part of Scotland have benefited. It was originally set up to reduce youth unemployment, but has become more specialised and supports the most disadvantaged young people in Scotland today. People who are care experienced, who are carers themselves, early armed forces service leavers, people with criminal convictions, and people who have disabilities or health and mental health issues. These are real jobs with a fair wage. And there are so many examples of the positive outcomes this programme has delivered over the years. And I'd like to just share one with members today. Isabel was employed as a youth and community assistant at Centre 81 in Gairlockhead. She said, "At the beginning of my placement, I lacked confidence. I was very shy. I had really low stamina. And this really worried me in relation to where I could maintain my placement, whether I could maintain my placement. Over the months, I've been really supported by my colleagues, and my confidence has grown. I can now talk to people much better, and my stamina has definitely increased, and I feel much stronger and able to move on to the next part of my life. I've gained knowledge and experience, and my communications with others has also dramatically developed. And I've also gained the skills such as patience, reliability, motivation, dependability, and flexibility. As well as having my goals of further education, I feel I've greatly improved my future employability prospects through this placement." And Community Jobs Scotland is good for employers as well. One said, "Through Community Jobs Scotland, placements we support develop and grow young people's confidence on placements. We're a youth project. While utilising their skills and to further develop youth work and outreach work, they recently has developed social enterprise growth and development within their organisations." In having this debate today, we're recognising the positive impact Community Jobs Scotland has had on over 10,000 young people across Scotland and their lives. The programme's provided young people much needed security while they've built up their skills to get meaningful and valuable paid experience with real responsibilities. Community Jobs Scotland provides flexibility and personalised support. It's given young people hope for their future and set them on the road to success. These third sector jobs have benefited every local community across Scotland as well. That means charities, social enterprises and community organisations can build their capacity and increase and enhance the vital services which they deliver. We've all seen how important it has been over the last 18 months to have the support of the third sector especially. And the 10,000th job that has been created in Impact Arts here in my own is a great working charity here in Edinburgh and Glasgow and Ayrshire and beyond in community art projects across Scotland. Over the years, Impact Arts has employed 155 young people through Community Jobs Scotland, from furniture restorers to graphic designers. Not only have so many young people been supported to develop the skills and secure paid fair work they need, but Impact Arts have also hugely benefited. In my own area here in Edinburgh and the Lothians, there are countless examples of interesting and conscientious businesses, like Homemade in West Lothian with its sister programme Mark, which has taken on and employed numerous young people since the start of the programme 11 years ago, or the Cyrenian Hospital Gardens and many, many more besides. This year, Community Jobs Scotland programme is expected to support up to 560 young people involving 176 employers across the country, which could be large household names, charities or small community groups. Like Isabel, most of the young people who come through Community Jobs Scotland go on to successful outcomes. Indeed, Community Jobs Scotland produces some better outcomes for the most disadvantaged young people in the country than any other employability initiative in Scotland. Now, we are here tonight, or this afternoon even, to acknowledge the success of Community Jobs. It's been a long day, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Which has not been that long.
Then we must, and we also need to recognise that we need to do everything that we can right now to make sure that this generation of young Scots get the support that they need and that they do not become a lost generation when it comes to employment. The Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations' recent submission to the Finance Committee called on the Scottish Government to extend and fund such programmes, such as the Community Jobs Scotland programme, for another year at least, until local employment partnerships are ready to deliver more employability programmes locally and ensure that the voluntary sector is included in comprehensive and inclusive whole systems response to the pandemic. I hope in closing the debate today, the Minister can outline whether or not this will be taken forward by the Scottish Government to make sure we have additional funding available. And finally, I'd like to thank members for their support for the motion, and I move it in my name today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. Yes, I think we're still at lunchtime, but maybe in a different place, we'd be at a different time. I now call Eleanor Whittam to be followed by Sharon Dowie. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Whittam. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and may I also congratulate Miles Briggs for securing this debate and refer members to my register of interest that I'm still a serving councillor in East Ayrshire. I can remember vividly the moment when my job centre advisor said she had an opportunity that she felt would be perfect for me. I was 22 and I had not long taken possession of my first home, a wee granny flatbed set in Kilmarnock, after negotiating the homelessness system and sofa surfing for what felt like ages. I was desperate for work, and as I tried to eke out my £37 per week JSA, I had become fixated in watching how much of my power card was eaten every time I boiled the kettle. Thankfully, the low rent meant housing benefit rules didn't punish me further due to my age, and with a mixture of family hand-me-downs and the lifeline that there was a Kilmarnock furniture redistribution project, I had created myself a wee home to be proud of. So when I was offered the chance of an interview for part-time youth work with an area of priority treatment-funded third sector project aimed at preventing car crime, I jumped at the chance. This post was created for a young person such as myself who needed a wee helping hand into the world of work. After much coaching from the job centre, I attended the interview and nailed it. I was elated and terrified to be offered the job, but thankfully the staff at the project also ensured that I was given the tools to be able to manage my tenancy on the £100 per week wage as I had lost all benefit entitlement. I absolutely loved my time with the Kilmarnock Car Project, and a year down the line when I was able to secure myself full-time work, they were made up for me as I took my next steps into adulthood. I've never forgotten the time and energy that was afforded to me by the third sector. As a councillor, I worked with many community trusts, voluntary sector projects and social enterprises who have given young people furthest away from the world of work opportunities through Community Jobs Scotland. This symbiotic relationship has meant that young people have been able to gain skills and experience in a person-centred, flexible and supportive environment, whilst the organisation has been able to tap into much-needed funding for staffing. These organisations are also often the lifeblood in our communities. An example in my constituency is Yip World in Cumnock, who are currently hosting their seventh Community Jobs Scotland opportunity, with two further vacancies being interviewed for last week for junior youth work posts. Janice Hendry, Yip World CEO, told me, "We are very aware that youth work is one of the best ways to engage with young people and give them confidence building and taking responsibility for delivering activities for children and young people, learning about work ethic and discipline, and of course gaining much needed qualifications and certificates to build their CVs for employment opportunities." The pandemic has tilted our world on its axis, and recovery from its effects is going to be a monumental collective effort. There's a shared ambition for the transformation of employability support and provision in Scotland through the No One Is Left Behind strategy and the Young Persons Guarantee. Currently, employability support is so fragmented, it really needs to be coordinated and managed to have the best results for young people and the public pound, more accountability and local governance. Phase 2 of No One Left Behind will support the acceleration in the move away from multiple and flexible national programmes, offering specific support for a time-limited period to a single gateway of local service delivery backed with the local intelligence and a more holistic and flexible package of support tailored to the needs of individuals and communities. There is a monumental amount of work happening right across our 32 local authorities to strengthen our local employability partnerships, and as all council leaders have signed up to delivering on the No One Is Left Behind strategy. Collegiate work is paramount here, and it is imperative that there is a recognition for the crucial role the third sector will and must play in ensuring our collective aims are realised. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Whittam. I now call Sharon Dowie to be followed by Paul O'Kane. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a pleasure to be able to join this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. We've already heard from my colleague, Miles Briggs, about some of the fantastic things Community Jobs Scotland has achieved nationally. So I'd like to use my time today to focus on some of the projects that we've been working on in Ayrshire. Presiding Officer, I recently completed my Summer Street surgery tour across South and East Ayrshire, visiting many different communities and encountering a cross-section of Ayrshire life. While some areas of the county are noticeably wealthy, others are not, often scoring high in the Scottish index of multiple deprivation and suffering from social issues such as antisocial behaviour, drug misuse and unemployment. When speaking to residents, sadly all too often they commented on how there were too few opportunities for young people, too little employment and as a result too few incentives for young people to remain and contribute to these communities. I share their frustration. I've lived in Ayrshire all my life and I've seen the traditional use of industries in the region fade away to nothing. As the parent of three young Ayrshire residents, I know how hard it is for young people to find work, particularly in a rural area like the South West, far from the bright lights of Glasgow or Edinburgh. That's why I found it really heartening to read about some of the truly remarkable work that the SCVO and Community Jobs Scotland have done and to turn around young people's lives in Ayrshire. Stories like James from Muirkirk in East Ayrshire, who, like so many people in the region, felt there was no support and sadly little hope of getting a job locally. CJS signposted him to a Street League employability course, which then led to work with ACDI in Auchinleck, where he specialised in helping people with mental health or learning difficulties. Now James works with the National Autistic Society, doing work he loves and improving the lives of others. The Carrick Centre has been another Ayrshire CJS success story. Led by Centre Manager Andrea Hutchison, this much-loved community centre has supported 31 young people through the scheme, despite facing enormous challenges thrown up by the pandemic. Andrea has been a stellar advocate for the CJS and the impact it can have in young people's lives. She highlighted the work of one CJS participant in particular, Alistair Stobbs. Despite experiencing barriers to employment, Alistair has become a valued member of the Carrick Centre team, developing his own skills to adapt to the pandemic, helping to set up online workshops, a weekly newsletter, and updating the website to enable the centre to stay in contact with its service users. Not only that, Alistair now mentors two new trainees at the centre. Alistair and James are only two stories out of the thousands that CGS has helped put their lives on track. Encouraged by employers like Andrea, CGS enables them to grow, both as people and as leaders, providing them with rewarding, meaningful employment that makes a real contribution to their communities. Any story of a young person succeeding is a good news story, but 10,000 of them is another thing. Absolutely fantastic. Presiding Officer, what SCVO and CGS have achieved is remarkable, and I am glad we can mark their efforts in Holyrood today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Dowie. I now call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking Miles Briggs for bringing this debate to the Chamber today. And as other speakers have done, may I congratulate SCVO on this significant milestone in the delivery of Community Jobs Scotland. Indeed, I recognise the immense contribution SCVO makes to society here in Scotland, supporting our voluntary sector to flourish and working in communities across Scotland with people from all backgrounds. Of course, we must also recognise the immense challenges placed on the sector, like all others, by COVID-19. But I think we would also want to celebrate, Deputy Presiding Officer, the way in which the voluntary sector in Scotland has risen to the challenge of supporting the most vulnerable people and, more widely, our cities, towns and villages in this time of crisis. I wanted to speak in this debate today, as prior to my election to this place, I had the great pleasure of working for over a decade in the voluntary sector. After leaving university, I landed my first job at Volunteer Centre East Dumbartonshire, based in Kirkintilloch, in 2010 as a development officer. And part of my role was supporting people to get back into work through volunteering and getting involved in community projects. And it was in my first year in that role that Community Jobs Scotland was created, and I was able to work directly supporting people into the new roles that were created across the voluntary sector. I met people whose confidence had been shattered, who felt that they did not have a pathway into work, and who felt that there were just too many barriers for them to getting a job. And as the motion says, these were people who had caring responsibilities, they were care experienced young people, folk holding criminal convictions, and those leaving the armed forces early or indeed living with a disability. Community Jobs Scotland offered a new avenue for people and a new sense of hope that they could gain the experience and skills needed to enter employment, not through unpaid or tokenistic work, but rather through a meaningful paid role for a fixed-term period with the support they needed, both whilst in the role and indeed to move beyond the role into longer-term employment. Voluntary sector partners such as Citizens Advice, carers' organisations and advocacy services provided roles that gave a strong standard of skills development and training, but perhaps most importantly, jobs that met people where they were, that took time to get to know them as individuals and indeed their needs and developed strong support within teams in their organisations. Deputy Presiding Officer, later in my career, whilst working for Enable Scotland, I actually managed a number of Community Jobs Scotland roles and was able to give that same support, having learned so much all those years before in East Dumbartonshire. I was reflecting and writing this speech about one person in particular who started in an admin role with Enable through Community Jobs Scotland, and then went on to become an integral part of our membership and events team, eventually running large member events and conferences. And indeed, that person then went on to leave Enable and to go and do other roles across the voluntary sector full-time and continues in full-time employment today. And I hope that that demonstrates the real impact of Community Jobs Scotland. And I know that other members have spoken in similar terms of their experience of it. I do think we should be a little concerned, Deputy Presiding Officer, as outlined already, that SCVO have outlined clearly in their briefing that Community Jobs Scotland will come to an end as funding transfers to local authorities. And I think we would want to see, certainly, the bridging that Miles Briggs has outlined in terms of the relationship between SCVO and local authorities. Because, in the words of SCVO, this is a successful national programme which supports young people into employment. And exactly at the point where furlough ends, it would seem counterintuitive to remove that, particularly when we've seen the examples of where young people can access the right support at the right time and then find that pathway, as I expressed at the start of my remarks, into work. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, in concluding, we have much to do to rebuild from the pandemic, and supporting existing and new avenues to employment for everyone who needs them, particularly the most vulnerable, must be our priority. And we cannot forget the key role that our voluntary sector has played and must continue to play. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kane. I now call Faisal Chowdhury, who will be our last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond to the debate. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I commend my colleague, Miles Briggs, for securing this debate today, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak. The significant contribution that the SCVO Community Jobs Scotland scheme has made to the lives of so many young people over the last 10 years cannot be underestimated. And it has been an honour to learn more about some of the successful cases, studies brought to the Parliament's attention today. Supporting our young people is a subject very close to my heart as we take steps together to address the devastating impact of the COVID pandemic on so many families and communities. Providing that support for young people must be about reaching all young people. All our young people deserve no less. To do that effectively means working in partnership, and Community Jobs Scotland's employability scheme has an impressive record in that regard. In West Lothian, I can refer to the example of the Larder project. The Larder provides work experiences and training through food productions, delivering of hot meals and operation of cafes. The importance of equality of access to good quality food, allowing everyone to dine in dignity, is at the heart of the project's goal, along with supporting young people into work. At the Larder, the feedback from 100% of those young people who complete the CJS program told us that they were more confident and felt that they had been given time to develop their skills in a supportive environment. I'm so proud to be able to bring the work of this project to the attention of my colleagues today. As the Larder say themselves, Community Jobs Scotland was a game changer for us and the young people we employed. Through its management of Community Jobs Scotland, SCBO is able to provide a level of tailored and specialised support for both employers and employees from many different sectors and industries. There is a strong record of partnership working and joined up referral process with partners in the development work and pension skills development Scotland. Local authorities, key workers, developing the young workforce and across the third sector. The implementation of the No One Left Behind strategy will bring changes. It is, of course, important that these changes are for the better and are well prepared. As the pandemic has placed significant demands on the work and resources of all those partners, I would like to ask the Minister if consideration has been given to delay in implementation date for those changes to ensure we do our best for those young people who are furthest from employment opportunities. I would urge the Minister to assure members that whatever lies ahead, the Scottish Government will take on board the very best of the CJS programme, to which so many have contributed so much over the last 10 years. We cannot risk losing the expertise that has allowed so many young people to benefit from the Community Jobs Scotland. This Parliament celebrates the achievement of all those young people, and I would like to join others in placing on record my congratulations to the 10,000th young person who to come through CJS. It was of particular interest to me that this 10,000 job is an impact arts. As already mentioned, the creative industries contribute so much to our society and to our economy, and I look forward to seeing many more young people being given the support to secure work in this sector. As the furlough scheme comes to an end and uncertainty dominates the labour market, I hope that we will continue to see coordination, focused support for those young people in our ethnic minority communities, those who are living care, those with conditional support needs.
Mr. Chaji, could you please bring your mic?
Disabilities, those already with caring responsibility themselves. I know we can also learn from the young people themselves who have completed CJS program, and I look forward to working with everyone in this Parliament to give all our young people a future. Many thanks again to Miles Big for this debate. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on the Minister, Richard Lochhead, to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, and thank you to Miles Briggs for bringing this motion to Parliament today. And I'd like to add my congratulations and thanks to the SCVO for achieving what is a very, very impressive milestone. We know that employability support, including programmes such as Community Jobs Scotland, is supporting Scotland's economic recovery and responding to the immediate labour market impacts of the COVID pandemic, as well as many members referred to. So we're very thankful to the SCVO partners and all employability providers across the public, third and private sectors for their flexibility in providing support to those who need it most and in their ability to adapt their delivery models to respond to the COVID restrictions and the wider implications of the pandemic. I think many members, Miles Briggs in terms of some of the case studies from Lothian and Sharon Dowie from her region as well, gave very inspirational stories about how young people have been helped in particular and had new pathways opened to help them get onto a career ladder and improve their life chances. So many, many inspirational stories from across the chamber. And Paul Keane, of course, has actually worked with Community Jobs Scotland and met many of the young people and worked with them as well. So he also brought some very colourful insights to the importance of Community Jobs Scotland as well. And as we turn our focus to delivering the priorities set out in the programme for government and for long-term recovery, we are continuing to take forward our no one left behind approach to employability. This is an approach based in partnership and collaboration to deliver joined up person-centred services through transformational change. It's about delivering a system that focuses on the needs of the service user first and foremost, and is flexible enough to respond to any unforeseen labour market shocks in the future. So that partnership and collaboration will be critical to delivering No One Left Behind, with services collectively designed at local level by local employability partnerships, comprising of representation from third sector organisations and other public sector providers, including Skills Development Scotland. Now, phase two, as you will all be aware, and as some people have referred to, of No One Left Behind is scheduled to come into force in April 2022. That is after a delay already to take into account the circumstances of the pandemic. So clearly the government wants to be assured that local employability partnerships are ready and able for phase two to take place in April 2022, and we are receiving those assurances. But of course we're having correspondence and meetings with SCVO and others to discuss some of the issues they're facing at the moment. But I think what's really important, and Elena Whittam emphasised the value of local decision making here and how that's a big step forward and how we have to support that. And of course I think there's cross-party support to have more decisions taken at a local level. So we do want to, of course, press ahead with that, but we are taking into account a number of the issues that have been brought to our attention, and we'll make further announcements in due course. Because we want to ensure that the value of Community Jobs Scotland and the whole concept is not lost, it's protected. But you know, Councillor Parry from COSLA did write to me just recently to reassure me that our local employability partnerships are ready and able and prepared for phase two. And I would urge all members to speak to the local employability partnerships if they have any concerns, and hopefully that will also reassure them about the future as well. But she actually mentioned in her letter that the local employability partnership survey was a genuine hard look at local policy and practice, and those survey findings highlight that even in spring of this year, more than three quarters of the LEPs funded third sector employability provision, and that was through local commissioning. 94% presently have a commissioning procurement framework in place or intend to establish one, and the vast majority are in favour of establishing a national framework for procuring employability services. Since that survey was undertaken, the LEPs and their processes have been further strengthened. So that's a quote from her letter, and no doubt I'll hand that to the official report later. And when I've spoken to the local employability partnerships in terms of Community Jobs Scotland and all the benefits and moving to the next stage of No One Left Behind, they are adamant and at pains to say, firstly, they're championing the bit to go on to the next stage of No One Left Behind to help local young people and others who are that bit further from the labour market, but also that they cannot see or envisage moving forward without the third sector being at the heart of what they do. But clearly that extra flexibility of working with some local third sector organisations, their own communities, and having that flexibility and local decision making, they see it as very valuable moving forward. And I think that's Parliament's view as well. So we will clearly continue our discussions and correspondence with the third sector organisations and the SCVO, who may have some ongoing concerns, because we want to make sure we can reassure them as we move forward. So on that note, I think I'll just reach a conclusion by saying that it's fantastic to commemorate and to mark this milestone that the SCVO have achieved and Community Jobs Scotland, and everything's been achieved for many young people in Scotland. And as I said before, many of the stories were inspirational, and that is the evidence that we need to hold at the forefront of our minds as we move forward to make sure these values are captured and promoted with phase two of No One Left Behind, as we support young people and others who we want to help go on with their lives, improve their life chances and get into the labour market at the same time. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes this debate. And I suspend this meeting until 2 p.m. Thank you.